Today I'm going to be talking on the Mulligans Flat and Goorooyarroo rabbit eradication programs. And before I start, I just want to acknowledge the Ngunnawal people, owners on the land that I'm on today, and acknowledge any other Aboriginal people and Torres Strait Islander people that are online. A bit of context. So Mulligans Flat is in the northeast corner of the ACT. It's only about 20 minutes drive from Parliament House, and we have a predator-proof fence similar to the model that Catherine was talking about earlier. The original sanctuary fence up at Mulligans Flat was completed in 2009, and then we had an extended sanctuary fence built in the south here around Goorooyarroo Nature Reserve in 2019. On both sanctuaries, we've got a lot of research going on, and in the Mulligans Flat Sanctuary, we've got a whole lot of cute, fluffy things in there. So just to recap on the Mulligans Flat Rabbit Eradication Program, a colleague of mine, Mark Sweeney, presented this conference in person a couple of years ago. So I'll just quickly go over the Mulligans story and then step into the Goorooyarroo. It wasn't an easy program to run because of, I guess, the timeline in which the program and the reintroductions and so on. We couldn't do a whole lot of the traditional things that you do for eradication, or things that we could do were fairly limited. So ripping was limited. We couldn't use 1080 and pindone because of the threat to little fluffy animals. We couldn't trap because of the reintroductions and the threats that posed to some newly reintroduced animals. We could shoot, be careful of what we shot, obviously. And we could do some harbour removal and log rolling. But again, we had to be very careful about that because we've got a long-term woodland experiment in there that ANU were running. So we had to be careful about what we touched. So here's the timeline I was referring to. So in 2009, the fence was completed. Significantly, foxes were removed in around 2012 before Bettongs were reintroduced. And I'll come back to that point throughout the talk. Then in 2014, we were asked, can you eradicate rabbits? It was obvious that there was an increasing impact from rabbits within the sanctuary. Towards the end of 2014 through to 2016, we undertook fumigation and we baited the whole sanctuary with RHDV, 450 kilos of carrot, and undertook shooting in different ways. Then in 2016, we had the quolls, eastern quolls, introduced or reintroduced, and the program really wrapped up at the end of 2016 when our last rabbit was shot. We had a whole throughout the program. The red line you can see here is the total number of rabbits shot, and the sort of blue-purple line is the rabbits seen per spotlight kilometre. Those spotlight kilometres were on set transects, and you can see that it sort of drops off to a point where it wasn't really effective, although we had rabbits within the reserve, so we had to step away from those transects to actually go and hunt where the rabbits were. The big innovation here for us was the use of Judas rabbits. So we GPS collared a couple of rabbits, put them in there, and they did two things for us. They tested our camera network that was out there. So if our cameras picked up those Judas rabbits, it meant that our cameras were working. But it also meant that the rabbits are social creatures, and they would go and find other rabbits within the reserve, lead us to the location of other rabbits in the sanctuary. So the lessons out of that Mulligans, the original program, was that it took forever, it was expensive because of the way we did it, and it was really tough on staff because there was so much nighttime work in grinding down the numbers mostly through the shooting, but it was very rewarding. I guess the big lesson here is eradicate rabbits before foxes, and, you know, if you probably speak to everyone in my office, we would have told you that before we started the program, but just because of the way things rolled out with the sanctuary, it didn't happen that way. And I guess having a strong camera network combined with your nighttime work of spotlighting, thermal and shooting, and the use of the Judas rabbits was very effective. So fast forward to 2019 to the Goorooyarroo Sanctuary just south of Mulligans. We undertook a whole raft of monitoring methods, including ground searches, spotlighting and thermal, camera trapping, use of detector dogs, again, the use of Judas rabbits, and finally, fox scat eDNA. So we walked the whole reserve and pinpointed exactly where the burrows were, where the buck heaps were of the rabbits, and any other sign we could find, and gave us a picture of where rabbits were within the sanctuary. Again, a whole lot of nighttime work, so out in the wee hours of the morning, doing some shooting and spotlighting, just gauging where rabbits were within the reserve and what their populations were doing. There's probably a couple of months worth there, and set up our camera network. And so here we've got about 80-odd permanent cameras, and then we had 20 to 40 temporary cameras that were just floating around where populations of rabbits were. And that was a fairly typical camera shot early in the program, front and centre, but also up the back. They were sort of quite hard to find towards the end of the program, more, oh, is it a rabbit, is it not a rabbit? Detector dogs were used, but not overly effective. We sort of had half signs every now and again of when they thought they might see a rabbit, but they enjoyed swimming in our dams more than anything else. Again, as I said, we used Judas rabbits. We put 5 rabbits into our 800-hectare sanctuary. Within about 2 weeks, we had 2 cleaned up by foxes, and we were able to retrieve those collars, and we've still got 3 in situ at the moment. There's our locations of where we found them, and it's quite interesting. So in when we had the collared rabbits, we found that they actually moved around the whole 485 hectares. Within Goorooyarroo, we have found that they have sat tight pretty much where we put them in. They found the nearest comfortable log or hole, whatever it is, and stayed there. And we put that down to having foxes in situ, that the rabbits basically don't want to move outside of their range. And that's reflected in the literature as well. And finally, we had volunteers out collecting fox scats and had them tested for rabbit DNA. So just to recap, we used a whole lot of different monitoring methods. We had lots of crazy maps going on, but it gave us a good picture of what was going on, where and when. I guess the messages here are that there was a lot of effort put in using a whole lot of different methods, some tried and tested, others new and emerging, but it gives us a whole range of to give us more confidence of that we're heading in the right direction. So onto our treatments. Through the summer months, we were fozzing warrens, and then we brought in the heavy machinery to do the real hard work of rolling logs and ripping some of the bigger warrens. Again, more nighttime work into the cooler months as well, where it was more effective. And all that sort of work gave us an idea of, again, where we should put our effort. And so when we started our baiting program, we narrowed the baiting area down from the 800 hectares down to sort of 6 main areas of about 200 hectares in total. We put out 3 free feeds of carrot and 1 bait feed of 1080 of about 30 kilos of carrot. Quite nice doing that in the evening. And then cleaned up a whole lot of stuff, a lot of target animals, but a lot of off-target animals as well, which we anticipated. And then once we ran the baiting program, we immediately followed up with a very intensive shooting program, again using spotlight and thermal. And then once we did have those animals, we you know, we'd open them up and check them for fat scores, check them for breeding, male, female, weights, all that sort of thing, to get an idea of what the populations was doing at the time. And again, foxes in there doing work for us. But just to recap, we fozzed and ripped about 130 or 40 burrows. We, our baiting program, we collected 34 dead rabbits immediately after that, but generally we found that rabbits were very close to their burrows or sometimes within their burrows, so we suspect there's a whole lot more in that we didn't pick up. 57 rabbits, and our fox was very interesting to us that we picked them up on cameras throughout the reserve. But like I said earlier, the real interesting part was that the Judas rabbits didn't really move around as much as we anticipated. So here's a quick look at, you know, essentially the program and the number of rabbits. When we did our sort of initial groundwork and a bit of shooting at the start, we took quite a few animals. Once our baiting program got the numbers right down, we sort of ticked along and picked up numbers every now and again. Last rabbit was killed in September last year. However, we don't actually know how many rabbits we killed, nor does it actually matter, because our monitoring team is doing pretty well. Who knows how many rabbits the foxes have eaten. We also point out that this program was run at some pretty interesting times. So if we work backwards from here, obviously everyone had to deal with the COVID shutdown at some point. We're a parks and conservation service, so we were very heavily involved with the big fires on the East Coast, and that took a lot of time away from us and our program. The other really interesting one was in that sort of March, April period in 2019, we had an incursion within to the original sanctuary where we had three rabbits get in. And that took a lot of effort away from the guru program. But because of the methods that we'd used through both of the programs, we were able to locate and remove those rabbits within the original very quickly. So the lessons from the guru part of the program was really put effort in at the start to understand what the rabbits are doing. Do a big baiting program and then a very intensive shooting program immediately after. Again, a strong camera network, spotlighting, thermal and shooting with Judas rabbits. And, of course, the obvious one is keep the foxes or predators until the program is complete. So what's next for the guru program? Well, we're not calling it yet because the grass is too long. In some places, it's up over your head where we are. We're going to kick off with a final monitoring blitz, I suppose, in July. Then we'll continue monitoring throughout the years to come. And, at some point, I guess we'll put all the cute fluffies back into Goorooyarroo. Thanks.
Thank you, Simon. That was an incredible presentation and I don't think you should feel insignificant at all. That was a humongous amount of effort by a lot of people. I'm only a little bit biased. One quick question from Robin Hall was why you didn't use RHDV in Goorooyarroo as part of your program.
Yeah, it's a good question. We did talk about it, but we didn't think conditions were right to use it. We thought 1080 would get us a better result. We had to put out a lot of RHDV to get the numbers down in Mulligans the first time around. So in Guru, we thought we'd probably get better bang for our buck, I guess, reducing rabbits through the use of 1080 than we would with RHDV.
Great. Thank you very much.